Hello, everybody. This lecture is going to focus on axial trauma involving the spine. And when we think about spine trauma, instead of dividing the spine into the traditional cervical, thoracic, and lumbar regions, I think it's more worthwhile to think of it as five zones. And that's how I'm going to talk about it today. Zone one is the craniocervical junction, and injuries in this area tend to follow along with injuries involving the skull and the face. The majority of injuries that we see are in the lower cervical region, extending from C3 to C7, very mobile region. We have relatively few injuries in the upper thoracic spine, and then our second zone of injury is going to be at the thoracolumbar junction, extending from about T10 down to L2, and then finally the lower lumbar region. And injuries in all of these areas tend to cluster together and behave in a similar fashion because of similar anatomy. Let's start first by looking at the plane film. And in the cervical region, I'd like to start by looking at the soft tissues. Now, the soft tissues above C4 are relatively reliable, and we should expect to see less than 5 millimeters of soft tissue anterior to the vertebral bodies. And typically, the place that I like to look is at the bottom of C2 and at C3, because you know at that point you're going to be below the adenoids. Once you get down below C4, the soft tissues are less reliable because we have the esophagus in this region, and the tissues can approach up to 2 centimeters or approach approximately the width of a vertebral body. Now, when you see swelling, there's a broad differential. It includes cervical trauma, especially cervical trauma involving the anterior vertebral body or the anterior annulus, but there are other considerations we have to keep in mind, including fluid tracking from facial or skull-based injury, vascular trauma, and even fluid overload can result in significant soft tissue edema. Another thing to do right at the beginning is to take a look at your lines of alignment. At the vertebral bodies, we have an anterior and a posterior line at the vertebral body margins. We have a spinolaminar line at the junction of the spinous process and the lamina. And then finally, a line that's not very reliable at the tips of the spinous processes. These have a lot of variation and can tilt, and I don't find that line terribly helpful. The posterior vertebral body line and the spinolaminar line are critical because those are the lines that encompass the spinal canal. And all of these lines correspond to different ligamentous regions of the cervical spine. And we'll start first by looking at craniocervical junction injuries. And these are injuries that extend from the occipital condyles down to C2. There are often multiple injuries in this area that go together. And we have to remember that injuries are particularly common in this region in children because of the disproportionate weight of the skull relative to the rest of the body in the younger child. And you can see that in the newborn, that about a quarter of the entire length of the body is made up of the skull, and that diminishes significantly with growth. Now, there are several injuries that can take place in this area. One of the most devastating of these is craniocervical dissociation, where the entire cranium shifts relative to the cervical spine, typically in an anterior direction and with distraction, though there are considerable variations in the type of movement that can take place. But typically, the skull will distract, resulting in a clear space between the occipital condyles and C1, and it will shift anteriorly so that the clival line at the posterior margin of the clivus fails to intersect the posterior margin of the dens as it normally does. Several measurements have been utilized for this. Powers ratio, where measurements are made between the basion and the opisthion relative to the anterior and posterior arches of C1 as illustrated here, and the line from the basion to the posterior arch elongates with this particular injury. A more simple method is simply to measure from the basion to the tip of the odontoid, and that distance normally does not exceed 12 millimeters. There may be a number of fractures associated with that pattern of trauma. Another injury that we see here moving down one level is atlantoaxial instability, and this is caused by disruption of the transverse ligament passing from the lateral masses of C1, holding the odontoid arising from C2 in place, abutting the anterior arch. Other than trauma, there are a number of other pathologies that can lead to damage of this ligament, and in particular, rheumatoid arthritis is a common cause for atlantoaxial instability, along with other etiologies that produce inflammation in this area. Now, the distance should be measured at the bottom of the C1, C2 space, and it normally does not exceed 2 millimeters. When we're looking for this injury, the flexion radiograph is more sensitive than the neutral or extension radiograph, and it highlights and brings out the instability of this particular articulation. Now, this ring of C1 can also fracture, and the typical fractures that we see here are either isolated to the posterior arch, which behave in a very benign fashion, or, more importantly, we see fractures in which there are injuries that are at both the anterior and the posterior arch, as you see illustrated here. And these are known as the Jefferson fractures, and there are several varieties of them, including patterns with 2, 3, or 4 fracture lines. This particular injury allows the lateral masses of C1 to displace peripherally relative to C2 and produces the typical appearance that you will see in the coronal plane or on AP radiographs of malalignment of the lateral masses. As we see here, the lateral masses of C1, the outer margin, should normally line up with the outer margin of the C2 vertebral body, and they are displaced bilaterally in this particular patient because of the combination of anterior and posterior fractures. At C2, the typical fractures that we see are the Hangman's fracture, which I'll illustrate in a minute, and the odontoid fracture. Now, odontoid fractures are classically divided into 3 types. The type 1 is very rare, and it is a fracture involving the upper odontoid, usually in an oblique fashion, not the tip fracture that is often mistakenly illustrated, but it's an oblique fracture caused by alar ligament avulsion, but it's very, very uncommon. The 2 common fractures we see are type 2, at the base of the dens, and then type 3, where the fracture extends into the vertebral body and often will involve the C1 and C2 articulation, resulting in step-offs at the joint surface, as you see in this particular patient. The non-union rate is very high in the type 2 fractures because they have very little bone in contact, and these have a significant risk for developing a non-union. Now, most patients with an odontoid fracture surprisingly do not have much neurologic deficit. This is really an all-or-nothing type of injury. If the fracture is significantly displaced, as it is in this example, it often leads to instant death and the patient doesn't even present. But for the ones that actually make it to the hospital, they tend to have a relatively benign neurologic outcome. This particular patient, unfortunately, didn't survive the injury, even though he did reach the hospital. And the ones that have the worst prognosis are those in which the odontoid is displaced posteriorly. Normally, on the lateral radiograph, as you follow the posterior margin of C2 upwards, it is continuous with the posterior margin of the odontoid. The other typical fracture at C2 is known as the Hangman's fracture, and it goes by another name. It goes by the name of traumatic spondylolysis. And like spondylolysis in the lumbar spine, it takes place between the superior articulating facet and the inferior articulating facet at C2. The remainder of the cervical vertebrae do not have a clear pars interarticularis region, and so we don't see spondylolysis in the rest of the cervical spine. But at C2, this vertical fracture taking place between the 2 facets results in an injury usually associated with distraction between the two elements that have now been created. This fracture, as you can see in a patient on the right, often does not have very much swelling because it's limited to the posterior arch. We recognize it because of some antrolisthesis of the C2 vertebral centrum relative to C3. The posterior arch is often retropulsed, and it results in widening of the spinal canal. So we don't see very much spinal canal compromise with this particular injury. Here's another example showing the typical antrolisthesis, more obvious than the last example that I just showed you, and also showing the retropulsion of the posterior arch of C2. So if we do our spinal laminar line between C1 and C3, you can see that the spinal laminar line of C2 lies posterior to that, and there's no encroachment on the spinal canal with this particular injury. It can, however, have significant impact on the patient if there is associated vascular damage, and we need to keep in mind that about 20% of these extend into the vertebral body, and a smaller percentage of those will then go on and traverse the vertebral artery canal and can result in dissection or rarely even transection of the vertebral vessels. Now, as we move into the lower cervical spine, we start to divide the injuries by mechanism. The mechanisms in the craniocervical junction are often unclear, but in the lower cervical spine, we can divide the injuries into several predominant types, the most common of which are flexion and extension. So you can combine either flexion and extension with rotation, producing various patterns of injury, and there are injuries associated with pure axial loading. So let's take a look at some of these different mechanisms. This is a benign fracture caused by flexion, known as the clay shoveler's fracture, and this injury results in avulsion fractures limited to the spinous process produced by avulsion by the supraspinous ligament. We see these injuries at the C6, C7, T1, and T2 levels. Above C6, the supraspinous ligament no longer attaches to the spinous process as it deviates away to become the nuchal ligament, and so you don't see the injury in the upper areas. And this patient has multiple clay shoveler's fractures. Note that these do not involve the spinal canal. They do not extend to the spinal laminar junction. The fracture fragment is typically displaced downward, as we see in these patients, and these should not be confused with benign nuchal ossification or nuchal calcification, which is quite common. That tends to be very small, and the base of the spinous process near those benign calcifications should appear corticated and normal. And here we see the corresponding MR showing the supraspinous ligament inserting at the posterior tips of these fractured spinous processes. Now, if the ligament is injured, instead of breaking the bone, you may have a pure soft tissue injury involving the posterior ligaments, and this produces variable patterns of injury depending on the extent of ligament trauma. The trauma starts posteriorly and then extends towards the ligamenta flava and then ultimately across into the disc. The first findings that we see are limited to the posterior arch, with widening of the interspinous distance and widening at the posterior facet joints. As the injury travels further forward, abnormal kyphotic malalignment is seen in the cervical region, typically focal to one level. The posterior disc starts to widen, and as the annulus tears, there will be antrolisthesis of the vertebral body above relative to the vertebral body below. These can be challenging to appreciate, especially if the patient is already in a cervical collar and is being stabilized. So these can be very difficult to appreciate on radiographs and on CT, But MR is an excellent technique for showing the ligament injury in these patients. In this example, we have multiple radiographic findings that I've already mentioned to you, but on the MR, there's intense edema in the posterior soft tissues and direct evidence of ligament damage and associated cord injury where we have disruption of the ligamenta flava. So this is the optimal technique if you're concerned about an isolated soft tissue injury to the posterior ligaments. Now, the flexion teardrop has components of flexion, but there's also an axial loading component to this particular injury. And what happens here is we see the same type of changes involving the posterior arch as you would see with ligament trauma, but in association, there's a characteristic fracture caused by compression involving the vertebral bodies. It's usually seen in the lower cervical spine, C5 and C6 most commonly, and it is referred to as a teardrop fracture because of the typical shape of the fragment that arises from the anterior inferior corner of the vertebra. This is associated with widening at the posterior elements, as I've already mentioned, widening of the facet joints. But unlike your other ligament injuries, the vertebral body in a flexion teardrop is often retropulsed. So rather than seeing vertebral body anterolisthesis at the level of the fracture, instead we will see a little bit of retrolisthesis, as you see in this particular example. And here on the CT and MR of that patient, these findings are again brought out. Wide open spinal laminar distance. There's some facet fractures that are on the more parasagittal images, not included here. But here on this central image, you can see the teardrop fragment and the retrolisthesis of the fractured vertebra, and MR nicely showing the posterior ligament damage directly, the edema related to the injury and the associated cord damage, which is found in the majority of these patients. We like to use some sort of a fluid sensitive sequence when you are evaluating for posterior ligament injury, either STIR or a T2 fast spin echo with fat saturation. Now, in terms of the facets, if the flexion injury continues, you can get more severe degrees of malalignment involving the facet joints. So normally, the superior facet of the body above rests behind the articulating facet of the body below. These can widen and start to slide, which is referred to as subluxation. The tips can approach each other, which is referred to as a perch, as we see in this example. And then the upper facet can actually slide down lower and become locked in front of the inferior facet, a reverse of the normal relationship. If this happens bilaterally, it's referred to as a bilateral facet lock, again created by flexion. Quite easy to recognize on the radiograph because all of the alignment is so grossly abnormal. Easy to recognize on your CT images for the same reason. And then shown here in axial is a reversal of the normal relationship of the facets. The flat portions are the articular pieces. The curved portions are non-articular, and we would expect to see the flat portions in contact, and instead we have the rounded portions in contact related to this particular lock. Now, if the flexion injury is combined with rotation, the lock may be unilateral. So the only flexion rotation injury that we really have to deal with is this unilateral facet lock. And in these patients, the degree of listhesis tends to be less pronounced. It can be difficult to appreciate on the radiographs. Here on the side of the lock on a parasagittal CT, you can see the abnormal relationship. And on the axial images at the level of the lock, the abnormal side shows the so-called reverse hamburger sign, where we have our rounded, non-articular portions in contact with each other rather than the normal flat articular portions. Let's turn now to hyperextension injuries. Hyperextension injuries often result in significant core damage relative to the degree of radiographic abnormalities we see involving the bone and the ligaments. And the reason for this that is that in the setting of congenital stenosis or of significant degenerative disease, as we have in this patient with disc protrusions and ligamenta flava infolding, that in this particular position, the cord is very vulnerable. The space for the cord is the least in hyperextension of all of the positions of the neck. So this particular pattern of injury results in neurologic deficit and may not have much to see in terms of bone or ligament injury. The typical neurologic deficit associated with hyperextension injuries is the central cord syndrome, which is motor predominant and affects the upper extremities to a greater degree than the lower extremities. And here we can see an example of such an injury. Notice that the CT shows degenerative changes, but really doesn't indicate that there's been a recent trauma to the spine. And yet on the MR, we can see a little telltale edema anteriorly and the profound cord compression. And this particular patient had an acute neural deficit after a trauma with a real paucity of bony and soft tissue findings. So if there is a new neurologic deficit, really MR is the way to assess these particular patients for the extent of cord injury and to evaluate which levels would require decompression. Now, occasionally we do see signs of ligament injury and fractures. Let's take a look at what we see in that type of patient. This was a patient who came in with an injury. It was released. The initial radiographs were normal, had no deficit, complaining of neck pain. And at follow-up, at 2 weeks, you can see clearly that there had been a hyperextension injury because we have hyperlordosis, a little widening at the anterior disc, retrolisthesis, and notice the abnormal relationship of the facets, which should be parallel in all patients. So we wind up seeing the changes of hyperextension trauma. Now, this can be associated with a variety of different fractures, typically little extension teardrop fractures, which are small fractures involving the anterior inferior corner of the vertebral body. And they differ from teardrop fractures. They're often smaller, they're often more horizontal, and they affect the upper cervical spine rather than the lower cervical spine, which predominates with the flexion teardrop type of trauma. Now, the upper thoracic spine does not get injured frequently. It's very protected and stabilized by the ring formed by the rib cage and the sternum. And it's best to think of this area as a ring. And so when we do see fractures in here, they're often in the setting of major trauma or in the setting of profound osteoporosis leading to bone weakening, allowing it to fail, or in the setting of a pathologic fracture. And if you see isolated fractures of the upper thoracic spine, particularly above T6, isolated fractures in this region should be considered pathologic until proven otherwise. And in this patient, we have such a case with a pathologic fracture related to metastatic disease in the upper thoracic region. This is a patient with multiple myeloma. This is often one of the culprits that results in compression fractures. And you can see in this patient with myeloma the salt and pepper appearance of the marrow and multiple compression fractures at the thoracolumbar junction and lower lumbar spine. Now, one finding I just want to mention in patients who have compression fractures is this finding of a vacuum cleft. This has been referred to as Kummel disease, where you actually see intravertebral gas. And this is a good finding because it indicates the presence of a benign fracture. It's something that we don't typically see in the setting of infection or of trauma. It's a sign of a chronic compression fracture and filling in with gas. So let's turn now back to the compression fractures of the upper thoracic spine. These are often heralded by the presence of soft tissue swelling, as we see in this example. Swelling on the left is a little bit challenging for us because if the aorta is unfolded, it will lift up the paraspinal line. So generally, I prefer to look at the right, but it's a little bit less sensitive. And the swelling is always challenging if there is a lot of degenerative disease or DISH, because those osteophytes will also move the soft tissues away. So it's helpful if it's there, but if you don't really see it, you still need to look carefully at the vertebral bodies for fractures. And they're typically manifest by anterior height loss in the upper thoracic segment. They may be multiple, as we see in this patient who has multiple compression fractures of the upper thoracic spine. Relative preservation of the posterior vertebral body margin in these patients. Now, in significant trauma, you can develop fracture dislocations in the upper thoracic spine. These tend to have more soft tissue swelling, as we see in this example. And in addition to the anterior height loss, we're looking for fractures involving the posterior arch. These are challenging with radiographs. They're seen much better with computed tomography because of the overlap of ribs and lung that we have in this area. And here on the axial images, we can see the multiple posterior arch fractures and displaced bone fragments involving the spinal canal. These are significant injuries. They may be associated with lateral displacement, and they have a very high rate of neurologic deficit. Okay, let's move now to the thoracolumbar spine, which is a common area for trauma. And in the thoracolumbar spine, the spine is typically divided into three columns. These columns, which were popularized initially by Holdsworth and by Denis, are the anterior column, the middle column, and the posterior column. And while the Denis classification has several shortcomings, it is still widely used. And I'll illustrate some cases of the various types of injuries described in this this classification. The anterior column includes the anterior longitudinal ligament and annulus, which are blended imperceptibly at the level of the disc, and the anterior portion of the vertebral body. The precise amount of the vertebral body varies in different classification systems, but approximately two-thirds is usually utilized. The middle column includes the posterior portion of the vertebral body and the posterior longitudinal ligament and posterior disc annulus, and then everything from the pedicle back is considered the posterior column. So the most benign injury that we see is the compression fracture, which is limited to the anterior column. And here we see a little bit of height loss, subtle buckling involving the anterior cortex. These can be very challenging on the axial images to identify, but you can recognize the marrow edema quite easily on the T1 weighted image, along with the fracture line involving the anterior margin of the bone. So we don't see neurologic deficit or mechanical instability in such patients. On the other hand, burst fractures involve the middle column. So you can see that there's involvement of the posterior vertebral body margin and a rotated and slightly displaced fragment of bone clearly encroaching on the spinal canal. And as you look at the normal contour, which should be smooth, forming a C on its side, that's distorted at the level of the burst fracture, where we have bone now retropulsed into the spinal canal. So you have the potential now for a neurologic compromise related to this retropulsed bone. Here's another example here showing the retropulsed bone pushing into the spinal canal compared to the normal contour where the posterior margin is relatively straight or even slightly concave. And if the injury goes across into the posterior elements, as it has in this case, it is able to result in two pieces that can migrate and separate from each other, and that results in widening of the distance between the pedicles at that level. Normally, the interpedicle distance should gradually increase as you move down in the lumbar spine. But in a burst fracture that has a posterior arch component like this, you can see that the level is wide and then it narrows below, which is the reverse of the normal expected relationships of the interpedicle distances. So let's just compare those two. Here we have a compression fracture and a burst fracture. At the level of compression, the posterior margin is straight, whereas it's bulging. At the level of the burst fracture, as the fracture extends all the way to the back of the vertebral body, and you can see the compromise of the spinal canal at that particular level. It takes very little force to produce a burst fracture in the setting of osteopenia. So what might have been a significant force in a young, healthy bone, mild compression can result in this particular pattern in osteopenic bone. The next pattern of thoracolumbar injury described by Denis was the flexion distraction injury, which he referred to as the seatbelt injury. And this particular injury results from forward flexion with a fulcrum of movement at the anterior abdominal wall. We actually rarely see this from seatbelts now that the shoulder harness is used. It's often an industrial accident or seen related to bicycling and motorcycling as the victim is thrown over the handlebars. And the handlebars create the fulcrum at the anterior abdominal wall. In this injury, there is ligament damage starting posteriorly and working its way anteriorly. And this results in posterior distraction involving the spinous processes and the facets. It can be challenging to recognize this on radiographs, again, because of the overlap of the ribs, trauma board in place, much better appreciated on MR, which will show you the ligament damage more directly, as you see in this particular example. So on the plain film, you can maybe confuse this for a compression fracture. There's a little bit of height loss, but what's key is to recognize the gap between the spinous processes. It often produces an empty appearance in the vertebral body where there's a gap between the spinous processes or increased distance between the pedicles at that level. Now, this can have a horizontal fracture that traverses all the way through the posterior elements, which is referred to as a chance fracture. So various combinations of ligament or bony injury that go across all the way to the back can be seen in patients who have these types of flexion distraction injuries involving the thoracolumbar junction. And the worst pattern of injury is a fracture dislocation. Here, all three columns are disrupted in terms of the bone and the ligamentous stability. And like in the upper thoracic spine, when you have such a severe injury, we can see changes related to lateral translocations and facet dislocations, as we see in this particular patient. Now, the low lumbar region is not commonly injured. It's very deep. It's very well protected by overlying muscle. And we see the same types of injuries that we see at the thoracolumbar junction, but with decreased frequency. I want to emphasize just a few injuries that are unique to this area. Fractures of the transverse processes in isolation without vertebral body fractures are seen in the lower lumbar spine. The fractures by themselves are not particularly significant in terms of mechanical or neurologic stability, but they may be associated with important visceral trauma, particularly to the genitourinary system, and occasionally they may be associated with significant hemorrhage, particularly in anticoagulated patients involving the paraspinal musculature or the adjacent psoas muscle. another injury, not truly a fracture, but more of a stress injury or stress fracture that we see in the lower lumbar spine is spondylolysis. This can be associated with spondylolisthesis, which refers to the slippage that takes place. But the defect itself is referred to as spondylolysis. This is a stress fracture of the pars intraarticularis. So pars intraarticularis means the part between the joints. So here is our superior articular facet forming the ear of the Scotty dog on an oblique radiograph, the inferior facet forming the foot of the Scotty dog on an oblique radiograph, and then the fracture resulting in the characteristic collar on the Scotty dog. Now this particular fracture develops in children. It's related to hyperextension activities, probably in association with some familial tendency to develop this, as there is clearly a familial incidence, and also an association with failure of closure of the posterior arch. So the incidence is much higher in patients who have a spina bifida occulta at that particular level. It's quite common and results in the vertebral body separating into two pieces, allowing antralisthesis. Here we see an example of a large pars defect with forward slippage of the vertebral body relative to the body below and posterior extrusion at the posterior arch, resulting in elongation of the spinal canal, as we see in this particular patient. These are most common at L5 by far, and the next level at which we're going to see these is going to be at L4. Now be aware that they can be unilateral, and when they're unilateral, they don't result in much slippage, so they can be overlooked on the lateral projection. And this produces a unique appearance on radiographs because of hypertrophy of the contralateral side. So this patient has a unilateral pars defect on the right, but the opposite arch will thicken and hypertrophy and produce this dense pedicle sign that we're seeing here at L5, which has a differential, which is going to include neoplasms that induce bone sclerosis, such as certain metastases or osteoid osteoma, which this can be confused with. So keep that in mind as well as one of the variations that you'll see with a unilateral defect. So with that, I've tried to cover the common injuries that you encounter in the axial skeleton. Thank you very much.